Greetings, fellow Bible readers. Welcome to week 20 of our Bible read-through. This week, we finish up 2 Chronicles and head into the book of Ezra. As we do so, we see the continuing history of the temple in Jerusalem and its connection to the spiritual lives of God's people. We see both its destruction as well as its rebuilding. So let's get down to the details for each day of this week. On day one, as we look at chapters 25 through 28 of 2 Chronicles, we see here the principle illustrated very nicely that whenever there's something in Scripture that you're not quite sure about, just keep reading, and oftentimes the Bible will provide more information and details. For instance, back in 2 Kings, we had heard about King Amaziah and his defeat at the hands of the nation of Israel, and it seemed maybe a little strange that that would happen because the Israelites were such a rebellious and wicked nation by this point. However, we find out in 2 Chronicles that there was a spiritual problem with Amaziah, which led to that defeat at the hands of the king of Israel. Then on day two, as we look at chapters 29 through 31, we see in the life of King Hezekiah the proper and godly way to carry out fellowship and unity illustrated. Unlike when Jehoshaphat and Ahab got along and truth and error were given equal standing, Hezekiah was more than happy to unite with the Israelites and even invited them to unite with him, but only on the terms that they turned away from idolatry and worship of false gods and instead turned in repentance and faith to God and his word in its truth and purity. Then on day three, as we look at chapters 32 and 33 of 2 Chronicles, we see the life of King Manasseh, who was a very wicked and evil king, even sacrificing some of his own children. However, we see illustrated here that even such a hardened and wicked sinner was not beyond God's power to change his heart in repentance. And so that's a good reminder for us that as we deal with people in our lives who maybe strike us as opponents of God and people who are very wicked by the way that they live, that we should continue to share God's word with them, trusting that the Lord, if he so desires, can change their hearts and bring them to faith. Then on day four, as we finish up the book of 2 Chronicles with chapters 34 and through 36, we see how God uses secular rulers and kings to carry out his will and purposes. First in King Nebuchadnezzar, how God used him to punish the people of Israel by destroying the temple in Jerusalem. And second in King Cyrus, how God used him to bring the people of Judah back to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. On day five, we look at chapters 1 through 3 of the book of Ezra. And as we look at those chapters, we don't get exactly a census being taken, but we do get an accounting of all of the people who returned to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. And what you may want to do is you may want to think back to the census back in the book of Numbers and how many people God brought out of slavery in Egypt and compare that to the size of the group that God brings back from the captivity in Babylon. It is a pathetically small group compared to what God brought out of slavery in Egypt. And so a reminder that God was not lying in any way when he said that he would only restore a remnant of that nation if they turned away from him. Then on day six, as we look at chapters 4 through 6, we see how the state and government can interact with the church and at times be a benefit and a blessing to the work of God's people and at other times be a hindrance and a negative to that work. Throughout all of it, though, we should always remember to trust in the Lord and not on the power of earthly leaders and rulers. Then finally, on day 7, we see that further driven home in the story of Ezra, how when it came to his return to the city of Jerusalem, he did not depend on the power and might of the king of Persia to provide him protection, but rather on God and his power. We also see, as we look at Ezra's genealogy, that he's got quite a number of famous ancestors, and so as you read through that short genealogy of Ezra at the beginning of chapter 7, maybe try to see how many of those names you can recognize, and the ones that you don't recognize, maybe pull up on Bible Gateway in order to refresh your memory of the importance of some of those ancestors of this man who would be instrumental in rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem. That's all for this week. We'll see you next week.